Australia.
Welcome to Travel All Over the Countryside. We're camped at Shady Lagoon, a top little campsite. Actually, there must be hundreds of Shady Lagoons all over Australia, but this one, in fact, is in North Queensland, about 30k south of Normanton, in the Gulf Savannah country. Tomorrow we're setting off from here to travel across to the Lost City in the Northern Territory.
Travel with us and see crocodiles in the wild, wild pigs at night, ride on a unique train, witness a spooky morning glory, camp on a remote beach, meet people of the outback, experience the magic of Lawn Hill Gorge with its waterfalls and ancient rock engravings, drive across shimmering salt pans, and much more as we travel to the Lost City. This lagoon is an oasis in a dry landscape, so it attracts a variety of bird life. We're not in a hurry, so we get a lot of pleasure by observing and filming the birds of Shady Lagoon. This comb-crested jacana attracts our attention as he walks on water. Well, almost. Abnormally long toes spread the body weight and allow the bird to walk on floating lily pads. They're commonly known as lily walkers or Jesus birds. Ibis and egrets are common here and feed in shallow water. This is the great egret and it's found all over Australia. This colourful little bird is a rainbow bee eater. And hanging loose in the tree beside him is this little fryer bird. They're honey eaters and nimbly extract nectar from blossoms while hanging like acrobats.
Underneath this tree here, we just found the bower of the great bowerbird. You can see the coloured glass and stuff he's got around there to decorate the playground. That's what this is here. It was lots and lots of hours in building that stick bower there, where the bird actually, or the male, performs for the female in the mating season.
The great bower bird is found right across the top end of Australia. The male carefully lays out his ornaments in the hope of attracting a female. That didn't work, better rearrange the decorations. Now, where should I put this stick? This looks more promising. It's time to put on a bit of a show. We leave the bowerbirds to play and concentrate on the lagoon. It's mid-September and getting towards the end of the dry season with the daytime temperatures reaching 40 degrees Celsius. Kangaroos that have been resting under trees in the midday heat come down to the lagoon in the late afternoon. The ibis doesn't seem to mind at all, and the kangaroos can't see us on the opposite side of the lagoon. Our patience has been rewarded as we take with us colourful images of life on Shady Lagoon. It's only a short drive to Normanton, the biggest town in the Gulf Savannah area, with a population of around 1,000. It's best known for its purple pub. The visual pollution people haven't been to Normanton yet. We stock up with supplies and take a look at a replica of the biggest saltwater crocodile ever caught in the world. It's 8.63 metres long, and it was caught in 1957 by Christina Polowski. It's a giant and was caught right here in the Norman River. Since crocodile hunting was banned in the 1970s, the numbers have increased dramatically. It's dangerous to swim in any of the rivers up here. Upriver, we've just come upon this large saltwater croc. It's bigger than the boat we're in. Saltwater crocodiles can be man-eaters, so we keep our hands in the boat. We're anchored and waiting for darkness. This is when the crocs are most active. Croc spotting tours are popular on the Norman River, and you're almost guaranteed of seeing crocodiles. Crocodiles were around in the days of the dinosaurs, 100 million years ago. They even attacked and ate dinosaurs. They can stay underwater for about an hour or so. So if you don't see any crocs in the rivers up here, don't think there are none about. You don't go to Normanton for the swimming, but it has other interesting activities.
I have 2 tickets, please.
A good way to get a feel for the history of the area is to take a ride on the Gulf Lander motor rail. We're about to do that right now.
And we've got 2 certificates as well.
The Gulf Lander train runs from Normanton to Croydon, a distance of 150 kilometres. The line was built to serve the booming gold town of Croydon, was completed in 1891. Normanton was a shipping port in those days and the closest town to Croydon. It was a very busy line in the gold rush days and carried 10,000 passengers a year. Unfortunately, the boom was short-lived. Between 1910 and 1980, the line was described as the least busy railway on earth. This long bridge crosses the now dry Norman River. The line is laid on steel sleepers, and they're the original ones laid between 1888 and 1891. Today, the Gulf Lander Railway is experiencing a revival of sorts. Tourists to the area see it as a great nostalgic trip and a different way to see the Gulf Country.
The ride on the historic Gulf Lander train ends here at Croydon, at the end of the line. You can actually get off the train here and stay overnight in the hotel. You can walk around the town, have a look at some of the historic buildings, see some of the old gold mining relics, and don't miss the general store.
In the boom days, Croydon had 19 hotels. Now there's one. It had 7 stores. Now there's one. The population was around 7,000, and now it's about 250. You can still buy most things you need at the only store in town, which houses a dusty museum out the back. And the storekeeper is full of information.
The store's 102 years old, and I think in that time it's only had 6 owners. I think I'm the 6th owner, and I've been here 11 years. One family, father and son, had it for over 50 years. So that's not a bad record.
Yeah. Croydon today is a friendly town with a colourful past. A walk through the mining relics in Croydon Park is like a viewing of modern steel sculptures. It's day 4 and we're driving west on the Great Top Road to Burketown. Many early pioneers passed this way, as well as famous explorers. One expedition left this blazed tree to mark their historic campsite.
This is the site of Burke and Will's last campsite on their trip from Melbourne to the Gulf of Carpentaria through the centre. It's Camp 119, the last one they made before they headed back down south when Burke and Will perished on the way back home. This area here is about 35 kilometres from Normanton on the Burketown Road. It's only about 30 kilometres from here to the sea of the Gulf of Carpentaria. But when you go up in an aeroplane, you can really see why they didn't actually make it. It's mostly swamplands and rivers.
It was 1861, and after making the first historic crossing of the continent from south to north, it must have been a bitter disappointment to not be able to stand in the waters of the Gulf of Carpentaria. Today, this area is called the Gulf Savannah, and it's cattle country. It's the end of the dry season, and the cattle tend to congregate near water, so we're extra careful when approaching and crossing causeways.
As we cross the Flinders River just down there, we look north and we could see some amazing sandstone cliffs. We're just going down now to explore them.
It pays to keep a lookout for interesting features as you drive along. These colourful cliffs of soft weathered sandstone are an example. The colours range from white through ochres to deep reds. Nature's palette is certainly colourful. The soft material breaks easily and wet season floods cut into these cliffs and slowly erode them away.
We've reached the Leichhardt River on our way to Burketown. As you can see, there's nothing running over the Leichhardt Falls today, which is a shame because it would be very spectacular when it is running over there. And the Leichhardt River is pretty dry. There's a waterhole there, and it's very hot today. It's around 36 degrees because it's mid-September and getting towards the end of the dry season.
As the waterhole slowly dries up, black brim stranded in the pool, search for food in the tepid water.
When you're travelling in remote areas like this and also very hot weather, you should carry plenty of water on board in case you break down. We've actually got 40 litres of water on board. We're lucky enough to have one of these auto fridges, which is a new sort of system. It's got a eutectic system in it, which keeps everything very, very cold, including the water. And it's very, very nice on a hot day to have a nice cold drink of water.
Crossing the Leichhardt River today is easy, but be very careful if the water is over the causeway.
On the western side of the Leichhardt River, you can find the grave of Frederick Walker. Frederick Walker was commissioned to try and find Burcombe Wills in 1861. He didn't find Burcombe Wills, and later on he died of Gulf fever while surveying the Overland Telegraph Line in 1866.
Walker's monument and grave is on Floraville Station, not far off the main track to Burketown. As we enter Burketown, the old town artesian bore catches our eye. This colourful dome of crystallised multicoloured minerals is rock hard and has been flowing freely since 1896. Water from 700 metres beneath the earth flows out at 56,000 litres a day, and it's hot, 68 degrees Celsius. In the 1800s, Burketown was a frontier town where fist and gun fights were common. It could easily claim to be wilder than America's Wild West. Built in 1866 as a customs house, the Burketown pub is the oldest building in the Gulf Country. The town's a lot quieter today, and a good place to catch up on some washing and a hot shower is in the caravan park. As Margie cooks up some local mincemeat, it reminds us Burketown in its heyday had a meatworks which produced tinned bully beef for the diggers during the First World War.
The broggers are friendly at the Burketown caravan park.
Broggers are common in the area and frequent the vast plains country around Burketown. It's day 5 and 6:30 in the morning. We're up early to see one of the area's exceptional wonders.
Look, it's all bunching up.
We're on the salt flats just outside of Burketown, and we've had a very heavy dew this morning, an ideal time for the morning glory. What we're seeing there is part of the morning glory. It's a very unusual effect. It only happens in two places in the world, here on the Gulf of Carpentaria and in the Gulf of Mexico. It's an unusual weather phenomenon. Very, very eerie. Hard to believe it's 36 degrees during the day and now it's probably about 9. It's quite amazing. It's always accompanied by a strong wind, they tell us, and here comes that strong wind right now.
Morning glories occur from the month of September to the end of October, and they only form when weather conditions are appropriate. The eerie atmosphere gives the Burketown Cemetery a spooky feel. Many of the graves here are of people who died in the Gulf fever epidemic of the 1860s. The fever arrived on a ship from Java and wiped out two-thirds of the area's population. The mystery fever caused panic and the town was abandoned for a few years. It's now thought it could have been yellow fever or typhoid. By now the morning glory has rolled through onto the salt flats. We get a better view of the tubular clouds, which can sometimes stretch from horizon to horizon. This strange cloud phenomena forms out at sea in the Gulf of Carpentaria.
Well, this is the Albert River. It's just out of Burketown and it runs into the Gulf of Carpentaria. It's a salt water, tidal, full of estuarine crocodiles. You don't go in there swimming. And this morning when we watched that morning glory come out, it came across the Gulf and down through here before it reached the salt pans where we saw it.
This was the port of Burketown with a boat from Java that carried the Gulf fever anchored. The fever was so infectious, all on board died within a few days.
Just north of Burketown, you can find the remains of the old meatworks. They're on the Albert River out here, and all that's left now is all this rusting machinery and bits and pieces around in the ground here.
The meatworks has long gone, with only a few remaining relics to remind us of a once thriving business. Cattle are still the main industry in the area, and we're on our way out of town to the desolate salt flats that cover an area of 360 square kilometres. Only drive on these salt flats in the dry season. They can be very dangerous when wet, and it's easy to get disorientated and lost. But it is an exceptional experience, with shimmering mirages in all directions. Our next destination is no mirage. It's a real oasis, Lawn Hill Gorge.
We're on the road between Burketown and Gregory Downs, about 117k down to Gregory Downs, and the road's very good. Fairly featureless sort of country here, so that savanna grassland like we saw as we're heading into Burketown.
But the road's good and it's an easy run.
At Gregory Downs, we travel west across the picturesque Gregory River. About 100 kilometres along the dirt road, we pass the colourful Constance Range. The gap in the range allows access to Lawn Hill National Park, a lost world, an emerald oasis in a dry wilderness. Before we explore the fabulous Lawn Hill Gorge, we take a walk into the past, through remnants of ancient plant species dating back some 15 million years. Massive Livingstonia palms dominate this dry creek bed, alongside giant ferns and twisted vines. In the wet season, this area is inundated with water and becomes a flowing creek. The coolness of the forest attracts wallabies and kangaroos, who seek shelter from the hot sun. It's siesta time. It pays to watch where you step here. No, this is not what it looks like. No dinosaurs have passed this way recently. This pile of brown stuff is solid, and it's called tufa, a rocky substance of calcium carbonate. These examples are fossilised. The holes are casts of plant material that have been encased in the deposits. Tufa is responsible for some of Lawn Hill's natural wonders, as we'll see soon. This spectacular sandstone hill is called Island Stack because it becomes an island in the wet season when water runs through the remnant forest.
When you're walking through the national parks here at Lawn Hill, make sure you stick to the tracks. They're marked with rocks on both sides. That's for a special reason, because outside there is very fragile. If you walk on those small plants, then you might damage the root systems to them, and it will take ages for it to regrow.
The Island Stack walking trail leads us to evidence of occupation by Aboriginal tribes dating back 30,000 years. This huge wall of red sandstone carries evidence of the oldest occupation. It's dotted with dozens of rock peckings, chipped into the surface like a giant outdoor mural. Aboriginal artists used this overhanging rock face for simple abstract paintings. The hand-ground pigments have withstood the elements and time. Close by is further evidence of ancient occupation.
This area here is known as a midden. You can see all the shells laying on the ground there. They're all discarded shells from the mussels that have been taken from Lawn Hill Gorge. The Aborigines would have eaten these many, many years ago. The best way to see the gorge is to take a look at it from a boat. You can bring your own boat or hire a canoe.
It's early morning and the best time of day to set out to explore Lawn Hill Gorge and its natural wonders. A short paddle across the main waterhole brings us to a significant site that explains the creation of Lawn Hill in Aboriginal mythology.
This is the Rainbow Dreaming Art Site. It's only accessible by boat. This painting here is Gungma, the rainbow, who was closely associated to the rainbow serpent, who's believed to have created Lawn Hill Creek.
And according to Aboriginal mythology, he still lives here in the waterhole. Beneath the surface, Darraldarri Waterhole takes on the appearance of an underwater garden, a watery world seldom seen by visitors, the world of the mythical serpent. In the dreamtime, the rainbow serpent, during his creation travels, formed this waterhole and the creek to keep his skin wet. He's still here in the murky depths of the waterhole, and you can almost feel his presence. If he leaves, the waterholes and Lawn Hill Gorge would dry up and become part of the surrounding dry country. Black striped gruntfish are more obvious inhabitants of the waterhole. It's time to continue our long paddle up Middle Gorge. We're dwarfed by 60 metre ancient sandstone cliffs. They glow in the early morning sunlight, and small plants with long tentacle roots somehow manage to grip onto the sheer wall. These towering ramparts were created 500 million years ago, after this area was under the sea. Abundant water attracts cormorants that fish in the protected waters. Cormorants are sometimes called snake birds because they look like a snake swimming in the water. We've reached Indari Falls at the top of Middle Gorge. Under the canopy of pandanus, it's like a hidden fairy grotto. Remember that brown stuff called tufa? Well, this wall is made of active tufa. The tufa has grown over thousands of years to create a natural dam across the gorge. This barrier splits the Lawn Hill system into two gorges. The upper gorge is 1.5 metres higher than the lower middle gorge. The mineral-laden water deposits small particles to slowly build the rock-like substance called tufa. It needs running water to activate the process, and the bubbling and the turbulence of the falls helps in the building of the tufa barrier. Nature's natural dam is being microscopically built. It really is a fascinating process when you think about it. It's hard to believe that just outside this gorge is a dusty countryside. It's time for us to drag the dinghy up to the top of the falls and explore the upper gorge. To protect the tufa, the national parks have built a wooden slide to make it easier. A short paddle through this tunnel of pandanus brings us into upper gorge. In case you're wondering why we don't have an outboard motor, any form of motor is banned here. If you wish to enjoy this pristine paradise, you have to make some physical effort, and it's well worth it.
Actually, the water flows like through here. All this water runs out of a spring.
A series of springs keeps the water flowing through the gorge system. We're in the top gorge of Lawn Hill National Park. What an oasis in the middle of nowhere. Fantastic spot. Only way to see it actually is by boat, like we've been doing, and you get to see all this beautiful scenery along the way. That's why we like to travel all over the countryside.
After you leisurely paddle up the Lawn Hill Gorge, it's nice to get a little shady spot like this underneath a rock and have a cup of coffee and something to eat. You've got to bring it all with you, of course, there's nothing up here. We've got some apples and dried fruit and a cup of coffee.
To reach here, it's a 6 kilometre round trip in the dinghy, and the temperatures can get very hot. Today, it's 38 degrees Celsius.
Well, we've come as far as we can go in the Zodiac, so we've climbed up on the rocks here to get a view down onto the top gorge. It's a fantastic view here. If you actually take the walk from the ranger's camp, you walk around the back way over there and end up on that other side, looking down this way. There's no actual path up here, just work your way through the rocks, but the view is well worthwhile. It's stunning.
We can highly recommend a visit to this amazing area. The track to Bathorn Station takes us across Lawn Hill Creek. This is a spring-fed overflow of the Lawn Hill Gorge system. We're in cattle country, and this track has many gates to open and shut, and sometimes they don't open the way you would expect. Whoops! Take two. That's more like it. It's Margie's turn to drive, so I'm on gate duty.
Make sure you leave the gates as you find them. They'll appreciate that out here. There sure are lots of gates on this track. Don't forget to shut them all.
For many years, the wartime blitz wagon was the standard for outback travel in these areas. This wreck serves as a reminder that modern-day four-wheel drives offer a more comfortable means of exploring the Aussie bush. It's about 100 kilometres to Bathorn Station on this backtrack, and it soon deteriorates into deep holes and choking dust.
You've heard about bulldust, but we've just driven through about 15 kilometres of bulldust. This is bulldust. Look at it. Look how thick it is. It's fine powder, like talcum powder. But it's everywhere, and the more the vehicles drive over it, the worse it gets. You can actually get bogged in this, believe it or not. Big holes in here, and you can't see them. Just looks like a flat surface. You drive into it, bang, hit the bottom, and you can get bogged in bulldust. That's no bull.
In remote areas, you find signs painted on anything that's available, and they usually point in the right direction. In this case, Bathorn Homestead.
We've reached Bowthorn Station. You're welcome here for a cup of tea, morning or afternoon. And after that dusty road, we sure need one.
The homestead has the appearance of a suburban backyard with lush grass and colourful flowers. This is the McGuinness family's oasis in dry cattle country.
Hello, where did you come from?
Oh, we came from Lawn Hill this morning.
Carrie McGuinness welcomes us and we're soon having our cuppa in the homestead dining area.
We get quite a lot of people dropping in for cups of tea.
Carrie's a writer and takes a keen interest in the history of the area.
And this is a Burketown area.
The McGuinness family were drovers. They arrived here on this horse-drawn cart in the 1960s. They built the homestead and set about running cattle. Today they even have 24-hour electricity, thanks to a modern solar power system that works exceptionally well in this sunny area. Kerry runs the homestead, while brother David, along with his wife and another sister, worked the 2,331 square kilometre property. In the middle of nowhere, the McGuinness family have set up a campground on the Nicholson River to attract four-wheel drive travellers. The huge property offers the adventurous traveller some amazing waterholes and gorges that have been hidden in isolation for years. There are no crowds out here, as David McGuinness shows us around his huge backyard.
We've come about 30k from Kingfisher Camp. We're just about to walk into what's known as Headley's Gorge, and in there, there's some rather unusual pebble holes.
There's no defined track into Headley's Gorge, and it's a boiling hot day. It's just over 40 degrees Celsius. We've arrived at a secluded waterhole under the wary eyes of a freshwater crocodile, and this must be his dinner. The red rocks are furnace hot. It's like walking on a hot barbecue plate. But it's worth every step when you reach the main rock hole at the head of the gorge. Margie's feeling the heat and decides not to follow David and I as we clamber up to view the gorge from the tall red cliffs. This rocky walk takes us on a circuit of the gorge. These are the pebble holes I told you about. They come in all shapes and sizes, with one thing in common. They were all created by pebbles and rocks tumbling around in wet season floods that virtually ground holes into the bedrock. This process, of course, took thousands of years, so don't stand around waiting to see them get bigger. From this end, Headley's Gorge looks at its best, a hidden private gorge that's certainly a gem on Bowthorn Station. It's now possible to visit this gorge, where you definitely won't be overrun with crowds of tourists, and you can swim here, if you don't mind the freshwater crocs.
Have you heard of a stromatolite? Well, we hadn't until now. David's going to take us up here in the bush and show us some.
We're walking across a reef that was once an ancient seabed.
This unusual formation is known as a stromatolite. It's the oldest known form of living organism.
Goodness, they're heavy.
Look at the colours in the back of this one here.
These single-cell organisms are millions of years old and once lived in the sea. They grow in high salinity waters and some are still to be found in the waters around Shark Bay in Western Australia. The water is fresh in the Nicholson River and we're taking in the warm glow of sunset as we head upstream to wait for darkness, when David assures us that we will encounter many crocodiles. Our first encounters are brief. Some just float like logs, mesmerised by our spotlight. Not so the millions of insects that quite literally get up our noses. They're attracted to our lights. It's amazing how quietly a croc slips under the water. These freshwater crocodiles are harmless to man unless cornered, but they still send a certain chill down your spine in the dark. They seem to be trying to outstare us. Now we spot something quite different. A wild pig is in the water on the far bank of the river. Wild pigs are a pest and David would rather shoot it with a gun than a camera, but this is a rare sight. The pig is digging under the water with his snout to find freshwater mussels. The shellfish are as big as a man's hand and have a very strong shell, which is no problem to the boar's strong tusks. We can hear his jaws cracking the shell to extract the flesh inside. This is rare indeed. I'd heard that wild pigs ate mussels, and David says in his 30 years on the property, he's only ever seen it once before, many years ago, and never at night and up close like this. And just remember, wild pigs can be dangerous if encountered in the bush, and now I can see why.
Left Kingfisher Camp and we're heading out to Hell's Gate. When we get there, I'll tell you why it's called Hell's Gate.
Since 1844, when explorer Leichhardt was in the area, many travellers have passed this way, and it wasn't always this easy.
Well, I'm standing on Hell's Gate. This range of rocks that runs through here has a small gap in it, and this is what they call Hell's Gate because back in the days when the people travelling across from Queensland to the Northern Territory, they had a police escort to this point, but the police escort wouldn't go past Hell's Gate. This end was unknown territory, considered to be hell. You're on your own after you'd left Hell's Gate.
In the 1800s, when the settlers made their arduous journey, this was wild country. Today it's still pretty wild country, and Hell's Gate Roadhouse is a welcome stop. The international airport proves the locals have a sense of humour. Food, fuel and repairs make Hell's Gate an oasis for today's travellers. Travelling west, the convoys of early settlers were on their own, and they were mostly on foot or sometimes on horseback. This made them easy prey to the local Aborigines, who used these rocky outcrops as hideouts to ambush the passing travellers. The local Aboriginals saw the pioneers as a threat, and even after they built homesteads in the area, the conflict continued, sometimes with gruesome consequences.
This is historic Westmoreland Station. It's the oldest homestead in the area still standing, and it was built in the late 1880s, and it was the site of a massacre.
Renegade Aborigines attacked the homestead when the station men were out mustering. Records are sketchy, but it's thought they murdered 13 women and children. One survivor, an old Aboriginal woman who was badly wounded, found the station men and told them the terrible news. Today, the historic sandstone building shows no signs of its horrific past. It's now used as a storage area for the property. To follow the story, we now travel further along the track into the Northern Territory and on to Wallagarang Station.
We're about to follow this track into the beach from Wallagarang Station to an area where the Westmoreland station men took their revenge.
Wallagarang Station is a working cattle property with 6,976 square kilometres of area that straddles the Northern Territory and Queensland border. With permission, it's possible to drive the 81 kilometres to the beach. It takes about 3 hours on the slow winding track that crosses soft sandy creeks and flat clay pans that can be rutted after rains. It's well worth the effort as we drive onto the 80 kilometres private beach. We're back in Queensland now and heading east to the more desolate end of the beach. The tide goes out for kilometres, leaving long mud flats that stretch as far as you can see.
When you're driving down the beach, don't be tempted to actually drive on this flat area. You can see what's happened to somebody here. Looks pretty hard. Get a stick and poke it in. Look at that. Just a thin crust on the surface, and below that, mud. Bottomless mud. Look at it.
We end our drive at part of the beach that has a bloody history.
A retaliation raid was carried out by the station men from Westmoreland. After they'd buried their dead, they set out and tracked down the renegade culprits, rounded them all up and shot them dead. They were buried somewhere in this area here, and it's now known as Massacre Inlet.
It was rough justice in those days. There's no record of how many Aborigines were massacred, and no one really cared. It was like the Wild West, every man for himself. Thankfully, it's different today. It's time to explore the western end of the beach. A lone fisherman at Tully Inlet certainly makes Bondi Beach look a trifle crowded. The wide sandy area around the inlet is covered with millions of seashells washed ashore by the prevailing winds and tides. Most people visit Wallagrang Beach for the excellent fishing, and they're a friendly lot. As soon as we say g'day to the Pilly and Black families from Mudgee in New South Wales, we're invited to see their catch. Mud crabs are abundant here. Who needs catfish when you have some tasty mangrove jacks for dinner? We're also invited to help eat the freshly cooked muddies, and these are the small ones. Life can be tough when you travel all over the countryside.
Well, you can camp right on the beach here between Massacre Inlet and Tully Inlet. We're right in the middle here. It's pretty breezy tonight, but great spot here on the Gulf of Carpentaria.
In the morning, we continue on to the amazing Lost City. It's 257 kilometres to Borroloola from Wallagarang on a reasonably good dirt road. This is the MacArthur River, and it's running backwards. The strong tidal influence pushes the water upstream as the tide comes in. And we're about 50 kilometres inland from the Gulf of Carpentaria. The MacArthur River was named by the legendary explorer Ludwig Leichhardt. Borroloola was established beside the river in 1885. Today it's a pretty laid-back town, relying on the tourist trade. A visit to the old police station is a must.
The Borroloola Police Station was built in 1886. It's the oldest existing corrugated iron structure of this type left standing.
This is the tree Leichhardt blazed in 1845. It was discovered near the Culvert River in the 1970s by Ted Martin. He saved it from the termites to be preserved here for all to see. It's day 15 and we're heading south on the first sealed road since Normanton at the start of our travels.
About 45 kilometres south of Borroloola, you pull off left on the highway to have a look at the Bacalara rock formations. They're very interesting.
These colourful eroded rocks are in the Bacalara range. I first visited them in the late 1960s, when its location was only known to a handful of locals. It also took half a day of bone-shaking driving to get here. The road has improved a lot, and these formations are just as imposing today as they were in the 1960s. These craggy pillars of ancient sandstone look as if they've been built brick on brick by some long-gone craftsmen. They in fact have been moulded by nature over millions of years to create what appears to be huge chimneys with narrow crevices running in all directions, like a giant maze. Follow the most used tracks and you can't really get lost.
It's about a two-hour walk from the car, right around the track through the formations here and back to the car again. And it's quite hot out there in the sun, so it's a real pleasure to get inside these little alleyways here, or sort of alleyways, in between the formations. It's lovely and cool in here.
The sheltered crevices are home to web-weaving spiders, and this batch of youngsters would have to be an arachnophobic nightmare. These baby spiders will float away on gossamer threads, carried by the wind to populate new areas of Bacalara rocks.
We were travelling along the highway, saw a bit of a break in the range and thought we'll investigate that. Come up this little gully here, then you're in amongst this little fairy grotto almost, just water running off the rocks over there, spring fed. Magnificent little spot, and you wouldn't even know it was here.
From one oasis to another, we're now 109 kilometres south of Borroloola.
Well, we're camped at Cape Crawford, and we're almost at the end of our journey, or at least the road travel section of it. It's taken us 16 days to get here, and we've travelled 1,510 kilometres and used 217 litres of diesel since we left Shady Lagoon. We've travelled some interesting country along the way and seen some amazing places. From here we have to leave the four-wheel drive because the only way into the Lost City is by helicopter.
Cape Crawford is in the middle of thousands of square kilometres of isolated cattle stations. This dry country has some surprises, and our pilot suggests a detour before we visit the Lost City. After flying 40 kilometres southwest over dry, desolate country, we arrive at an escarpment, part of the Umbool-Garry fault line that runs through the area. This is Paradise Pools, an isolated oasis that is destined to become a high adventure tourist attraction. Fed by underground springs, the pools never dry up, and after the wet season, the falls are spectacular. We're getting an exciting view of the gorges and pools from the small helicopter as we manoeuvre between the chasm walls. It's a spectacular place, and apparently the fishing is good as well. Kilometres east is our objective, the Lost City, this needle-like pinnacle is protruding from the desert. It could be an ancient city of weathered skyscrapers, long since abandoned to the elements. These weathered sandstone columns were discovered in 1887 by a drover moving cattle from the east coast to Western Australia. He must have been awestruck when wandering through these natural wonders. The weathering of the sandstone has left some strange shapes balanced on the tops of some of the pillars. Some of the columns seem to defy gravity as they lean precariously with bulbous tops. The chopper only carries one passenger at a time, so Margie flies in on a second trip.
Well, this is the Lost City. Doesn't Australia have some fantastic geological formations? This has to be one of the best. Well, let's just go and have a closer look at it.
There are hundreds of pillars in the Lost City, and they average 50 metres high, some towering much higher. It's hard to imagine this area was once under the sea. Layers of sand were deposited that eventually turned to sandstone, which has gradually been eroded by rain and wind to create these colourful towers. We feel very small indeed as we explore the multicoloured Lost City. Why do you think the local Aboriginal tribes regarded this as men's country?
It's absolutely amazing, this, isn't it? Makes you wonder how many millions of years it took for those rocks, sandstone rocks here, to erode down to make these fantastic pillars here at the Lost City. Incredible.
It's a real privilege to be here. It's a special place that will remain in our memories forever.
Well, after looking at the Lost City, you'll surely want to come along and join us next time we travel all over the countryside. We'll be right back.